Praise God, it's lovely to be in the house of the Lord. And what a wonderful day it's been. Is it just me that saw that?
Yeah.
Oh, we opened the service earlier with the Psalm 119, verse 24. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. But we're not opening our service with that today. Before we open our service in prayer, I'm going to give you some notices, and then we're going to start the real worship, praise, and word. And I pray that God will touch each and every one of us here today. I'd like you to stand on your feet for a second, please. Stand on your feet. Right. If you are subscribed to the YouTube channel Church Community, take a seat for a moment. Have a look around. I'm naming and shaming. If you're not subscribed, consider prayerfully whether you'd like to. Everything that we produce is on there. And it gives the adverts and it tells you what the services are. So please do. It allows us to be a snowball effect with the gospel in and around this town of Redditch. So do sign up if you can. Encourage others too. And it will be that snowball effect as we reach many men and women and children. I'll tell you a story. If everyone could stand back up again, sorry. I'll tell you a story. I was walking through Redditch, and when I first started ministering in Redditch, someone came up to me and said, "I know you." And I went, "Do you?" And they went, "I've seen you on YouTube." And I thought, no. I thought they're taking the mic. I thought they'd been watching Mission Impossible with Tom Cruise or what's his name, the pop singer, Chelsea. What's the pop singer that we were talking about earlier? Harry Styles, was it? Yeah, I thought they'd think I'm Harry Styles. But no, they had seen me on YouTube and they'd watched one of our preaches. So it is rolling out and it is reaching people. So that is the importance of the gospel. And I was speaking to someone today from Cambridge in one of the churches. And due to the YouTube channel, they're going to invite and bring us down to Cambridge to preach. So it has meaningful reasons to connect and connect and network. So God's word can go forth and we can evangelize in all these pockets, these highways and byways, Cambridge being one today. So, the things that we do throughout the week, I'll let you know. Tuesday this week, we're meeting at 1 p.m. outside this church as fellowship. We're going to pray, we're going to meet, and we're going to bless the place where we are today by doing a very simple litter pick. We'll be a witness in the area. We're going to weed out the front and around the building, and we're going to bless Major Dawn, who's currently still suffering with the back, but also on holiday for a week. But we're going to bless her because she facilitates so much in this place. We want to honour her and we want to honour the Salvation Army here, this church, everything that the congregation is facilitating. And we're very blessed to be with our brothers and sisters in this place. That is Tuesday, 1 p.m. That's out the ordinary of the normal programme. And we're going to be doing lots around pockets of Redditch as a witness. Evangelism and talking to people that we meet. That's why we're out there. But we're also going to bless this place. Then Wednesday, we have our PowerHouse service. A little bit similar to this. Doors are open. We have the word preached. We have worship, praise, and we invite people in, 1 till 2 every Wednesday. And if you can't be here physically, you can watch it online on the YouTube channel. And then 6 till 7, we've got the Bible study, youth and adults. And again, it's the opportunity for people to see what we do here remotely and then engage. That's what we're trying to do. So we're inviting people through the channel and then saying, come next week. It is serving a purpose. Then Thursday. Oh, you can sit down for a second if you want. Yeah, we're playing Jack in the Box today. Thursday, the Worship Academy, 6:30 to 8:30. We're at Presence again. We see people come in and we're meeting needs spiritually, but also physically. The food bank that operates out of here, we're having people come in and they're engaging and we're giving them the gospel. Then Friday, we've got the luncheon, 12 p.m. We meet, we give a gospel message, a meal, we sit down for fellowship and we're seeing fruit there. The Recovery Cafe, 2:30, 4:30. You can come. Matthew came for a free cup of tea the other day.
Yeah.
That was the only reason, wasn't it? A free cup of tea and a biscuit. Yeah, you do sometimes. And it's a blessing, a blessed time. And you're very instrumental in serving now, aren't you? So God is stirring. Then, on the Saturday, nothing this Saturday, but last Saturday, you missed the prayer walk where Numbers, it was only yesterday, I'm forgetting where I am, but yesterday, Numbers swelled and we had a great time of prayer. And God is only seeding and building on the back of all the prayer that is now going in. I'll get into my sausage roll in a minute. And then Saturday evening, we had the evening worship. And for those that were here, it was a great time of worship and praise in this place. We'd love to see you at the monthly prayer, praise and worship that happens. And then Sunday a.m., we're representing a number of churches around Redditch. All, I think, seeing bubbles of growth. The ones that are preaching the word are growing. The ones that are staying true to God's word and God's promises are growing. And that is true. And then, Sunday afternoon, we're out into the Churchill Estates with our youth service, youth-led, and it's pleasant. It's good to be in the house of God and be receiving. And it was special today, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Amen. And Sunday evening, we're back here, 6 till 7, for the gospel service. Other things on the map, on the horizon, they're all seeded through the YouTube channel. But in the coming days, weeks and months, if you meet a mother, a parent, mother, father, with a child, what do you say to them?
Come on down to the Baptist church.
Amen. I bet you didn't think I was going to say that. You say, do you know Jesus Christ as Lord and Saviour? But let me invite you to the Baptist Church for free breakfast. They will give you fellowship, they will give you the gospel, and they will journey with you. What a wonderful weekend. Pardon? 9:30 till 10:15 for 4 weeks of the summer holidays. What a blessing. That's real church, isn't it? And then if they're still hungry, they can come here for a food parcel. That's collaboration, isn't it? That's churches working together. For one aim, for every man, woman, and child to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Saviour. Amen. Yeah. 1 p.m. we're at Greg's every Sunday. Come there. Be there or be square. I'm starting to look a bit round with my there we go. Right, we're going to open the service in prayer officially, and we're going to move into the things of God. Mike. Open up the service in prayer for us, please.
Heavenly Father, we just thank you for the wonderful things that you have done for us, Lord. Lord, that wonderful gift that you gave on our behalf, our Lord Jesus, King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, we thank you for him, Lord. And we praise your holy name, Lord, that you have given us this opportunity to use this building to get together, Lord, in fellowship, to glorify your name and to bring honour and glory to you, Lord. I pray that we would be the true lights of this world, Lord, to go out into the darkness, Lord, and to shine brightly, Lord, and to direct each and every person towards you, Lord. Lord, I pray that our lives would be a true testimony of what you have done for us, Lord. Lord, and that you would use us for your glory, Lord. Everyone has a testimony, Lord, and we pray, Lord, that those testimonies would be used, Lord. So help us, Lord, to have wonderful fellowship tonight, Lord, to have a great time, Lord, lifting up and rejoicing the glorious things that you have done, Lord, in your precious name, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. And we turn to Scripture, and it's no mistake that we turn to Psalm 86. For those that were at the youth service, we looked at Psalm 86, so it's got relevance to us today. But Psalm 86, we'll read around the congregation here today. I'll start and we'll move around. Psalm 86. Hear, O Lord, and answer me, for I am poor and needy. Guard my life, for I am devoted to you. You are my God. Save your servant who trusts in you. Verse 3.
Have mercy on me, O Lord. For I call to you all day long. Bring joy to your servant. For to you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. Verse 1.
You are forgiving and good, O Lord, abounding in love to all who pray to you. Hear my prayer, O Lord. This is my cry for mercy.
When I am in distress, I call to you, because you answer me. Among the gods, there is none like you, Lord. No deeds can compare with yours. All the nations you have made will come and worship before you, Lord. They will bring glory to your name. Verse 10.
For you are great and wondrous names. You are alone. You alone are God. Teach me your way, O God. I may walk in your tree. I will praise you, O my God, O my God. I will glorify your name, for greater is your God towards me. You have delivered me from death, from the land of the dead. Verse 14.
The arrogant are attacking me, O God. A band of ruthless men seeks my life, men without regard for you. But you, O Lord, are a compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. Verse 16.
Oh, turn to me and have mercy on me. Give your strength to your servant and save the son of your maidservant. Show me a sign for good, that those who hate me may see it and be ashamed, because you, Lord, have helped me and comforted me.
Praise God. Verse 9, if you want to turn back to that. All the nations you have made will come and worship before you, O Lord. They will bring glory to your name. Even around the assembly tonight, we've got one or two of the nations represented. But God, he's stirring so much, much more. We're encountering people from all corners of the globe, in and around Redditch, and we're professing the word, God will stir and lead. But then verse 12, I will praise you, O Lord my God, with all my heart. I will glorify your name forever. Whatever we've come in with today, whatever we may be on our minds, we might have been carrying, we just lay that before the Lord now. And as we stand and we're led in worship, I will praise you, O Lord my God, with all my heart. I will glorify your name forever. Let us stand and sing. 601. Lord, I come to you. Let my heart be changed, renewed. Let us stand and sing.
Lord, I come to you, let my heart be changed. Your spirit leads me on.
The next song is number 517, Purify My Heart. Purify My Heart. 237. 237.
just to encourage you all that you never know when you're ministering or preaching the gospel, when you are doing something, you might not see always the results. When I was at St. Andrew's today at PowerHouse, John, what's his surname? John Harding. He was talking about a young man who's been, well, not that young, a guy been into their church in the morning. And he'd heard the gospel about 40 years ago. Apparently, he used to come to the Sunday school of the youth that I was helping to run before I was a minister, even before I was a pastor. So he said, I've never forgotten those things that I was taught. I've never forgotten the gospel. He said, I've never really lost my faith in God. He said, but I do feel that I need to start coming back to church and back to God. And he promised he's going to be there. All I can say is his name is Wayne. I've an idea in the back of my mind who it might be. But the important thing is we share, we give, and then we let God give the increase in his time. And that young man, obviously, I think he'd actually been to the OG once or twice a number of years ago. So keep on sowing the seed. Keep on giving. Because your labour is never in vain in the Lord. Amen.
Praise God. And I think I shared with a few people the other day as well. Some of you know that I like to attend Greg's every so often in the week. But as I was coming out of Greg's, I bumped into one of my youth from not so many years ago, because I'm not as old as David, but 20 years ago. And faithfully sowing the seed, that person is still journeying with the Lord, but also being drawn back into the things of God. It is that fertile soil that is produced and that good seed that goes in, that germinates in God's time, God's way, and God's will. And God is stirring something and bringing him back, not in the case of this youth that I knew, but bringing back the prodigals, those that have gone a little bit cold and walked away from the things of God and started to get fired back up. When they see real church, the real proclamation of the word and the spirit moving, it's infectious and it draws. And it builds, roots, and extends. You cannot stop the gospel multiplying and reaching many from those faithful few seeds that are sown. So let us keep sowing in this season and beyond. We're going to turn to scripture now as we look at Romans chapter 8 in particular. And we're going to do the bookends of Romans. We're going to read from the beginning and a bit from the end. And we're going to see what God speaks to us from that. Romans chapter 8, verses 1 to 11. And then we're going to move into Romans chapter 8, 26 to 39. And I'll move us around accordingly. So Romans chapter 8, 1 to 11. Romans chapter 8. 26 to 39, and we'll read now. Life through the Spirit. Therefore, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life set me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do, in that it was weakened by the sinful nature. God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful man to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in sinful man, in order that the righteous requirements of the law might be fully met in us, who do not live according to the sinful nature, but according to the Spirit. Those who live according to the sinful nature have their mind set on what that nature desires. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their mind set on what the Spirit desires. The mind of sinful man is death, But the mind, controlled by the Spirit, is life and peace. The sinful mind is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those controlled by the sinful nature cannot please God. You, however, are controlled not by the sinful nature, but by the Spirit, if the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, your body is dead because of sin, yet your spirit is alive because of righteousness, and if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through His Spirit who lives in you. Then we move into Romans chapter 8, verses 26 to 39. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us with groans that words cannot express. And He who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints in accordance with God's will. More than conquerors. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. For those God foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those He predestined, He also called. Those He called, He also justified. Those He justified, He also glorified. What then shall we say in response to this? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare His own Son, but gave Him up for us all, how will He not also, along with Him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. Knowing all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor demons, neither the present, nor the future, nor any powers, neither height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Praise God. How do you even begin to share that? I mean, I pray that the guy there heard all he needed to hear. But praise God, the Word of God speaks for itself. Dead to sin and alive in Christ. Wow. All the past, the muckiness, the murkiness, all sin dealt with through the work of Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:17, paraphrase. We often talk about it. If anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. The old has gone. The old, what is that? The sin, the baggage, the rubbish that we all carry. Because when they're in Christ, Christ is in them. They are redeemed, they are saved, and they become that new creation, that new creature in Christ. Boy, I get excited more and more. The more people I meet in society, the more people I meet in the highways and byways. What a promise. For those who call on the name of the Lord will be saved. Each and every single one of them. They start that journey, that pledge, that commitment. They put that flag in the sand, that line in the sand, and start that new chapter, that new day, that new life in and with Christ. Praise God. Can I hear an amen? Yeah. Amen. I thought I was preaching to heathens for a minute. Yeah. We've got that promise, haven't we? If we know and love Jesus Christ as our Lord and Saviour. And then, the bookend of that, dead to sin, alive in Christ. Bang, wow. I want it. Freely given to each and every man, woman and child. We just have to say yes and call on Jesus Christ and say, Lord, I live for you. Live in me. Take my life. Let it be consecrated all to thee. Was that right? Yeah, lovely. I haven't sung that for ages. I've been humming it throughout the week. And I'm, you know, praise God, he sewed it into the talk. But then we are more than conquerors. Wow. Again, that excites me. More than conquerors. I shared a little bit of my testimony this morning, so I won't bore anyone with that who's heard it. But Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Alan, come back again. When I'm stumbling for the words, you're there, word perfect, you're a blessing. Praise God. You're like an auto cue. And I need that with my mind. And as I'm getting older, I'm realising, I'm losing it all. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Without Christ, we're nothing. In Christ, with Christ, boy, more than conquerors. And I often, I'm a sad little fellow, sometimes I read about all these empires, all these conquerors, all these, you know, earthly conquerors, what they achieve in battle, in warfare, they spread out, they rippled out, and they have country after country after country. Yeah, in the earthly things, they achieved things. But in Christ, we should be moving forward, claiming every footfall for Christ. And when we do that, every footfall of every household, we walk up. I don't walk like this up people's drives. So, that's why I've got a few restraining orders. As we walk up people's drives and we knock on their doors, the presence of God, goes before, goes within and rests in that place. And God moves and builds his empire. The empire of men, women and children, lost souls, bowing the knee, proclaiming Jesus is Lord, and that empire of sin coming to a saving knowledge of Christ, more than conquerors through Christ, who strengthens each and every one of us, to use Philippians 4:13 there, more than conquerors. And it states, doesn't it, and I love this, I mean, more than conquerors, where is it? 8:38, for I am convinced that neither death, nor life, neither angels, nor demons, neither the present, nor the future, nor any powers, neither height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And it says, doesn't it, about hardship earlier on. It talks about the hardship of persecution, of famine, of nakedness, danger and sword. For some of those out there, they live dangerous lives, don't they? Dangerous lives, hand-to-mouth existence. The homeless, the drunks, the druggies. You know, all these people that are living in a very hostile, dangerous world. For those that are living in famine, for those that are living in war-torn areas. All of that is dross. All of that is the decay and sin of the world. When we are in Christ and Christ is dwelling in us, all those things are like dominoes just blow down before us. They are just blown through with the Holy Spirit. And easy to say, I'm not in chains for the gospel, not yet. I'm not in prison for the gospel. But our brothers and sisters that truly are facing persecution, even as we speak around the world today, we don't say it glibly. They're there because of Christ. They're empowered through Christ. And they face that persecution head on because they are filled of God. To such overflow, we have it so easy. If we go to someone's door and we have a door slammed in our face, we have someone spit at us or threatened to give us a slap, nothing is it. Pales into insignificance the persecution that we may face in this country, in this town, and this time. We should be out there professing the gospel at every opportunity, sharing the good news of Christ, and drawing many into the fold. We are blessed, and it's such a privilege. But even when we face that persecution, nothing can separate us. Nothing can rip us or cleave us. No, we aren't cleaved. Nothing can uncleave us from the things of God. We're so attached. I was trying to think of an analogy because I didn't prepare this talk. I'm prepared. It's almost like an umbilical cord, isn't it? We're fed. We're attached. We're inextricably linked. And it is that cord of love that God extends to each and every one of us. We're fed through the Holy Spirit. We're fed through the power of God working in us. And nothing can come against that. Inextricably linked to the things of God. More than conquerors. Through and in him. So when we go into the town and we plod along and the world is falling down around us, we're more than conquerors. We can hold our head up high because Christ is on the move. Christ is just waiting for us to extend the hand and invite people into the things of God. His Holy Spirit waiting to touch, anoint, and deliver. You excited, Mom? I'm excited, yeah. I'm excited. So we can start, because I realise time is against us. We can start even in the small things. On Tuesday, 1 o'clock, fellowship together, we can actually see God moving. In the mundane, in the simple, in the opportunities to reach every man, woman and child that walks past. We're praying them into being there at that specific time. We're praying God will move on them. I'll share a quick story. I think I shared it the other day. I came to the toddler group, not as a toddler, don't worry. I didn't dress up in my baby grow just so I could come in. I came to the toddler group just before we had PowerHouse. And as I drove into the car park, I thought, oh, you know, where am I going to park? It was heaving. Loads of young people here in the things of God, in the fellowship in this place. It was wonderful. So I thought, right, I'll drive around the block and I'll park. Nowhere to park. I thought, I might even go and visit David for 15 minutes just so I can park. And I thought, no. I won't bother. I think I did actually come and see, not for that reason, but we had a little chat. And then I jumped back in the car, drove back round the block, and I was thinking, where am I going to park? So I parked on the most extreme remote part of somewhere down there. As I parked there, a guy who I think you saw on the Wednesday come in and fellowship with us, he looked and he just went, "You're not who I thought you was." And I said, "Who was you looking for?" And we had a chat. And of course, within that chat, he needed Christ. He came here, he parked up, we connected with him on Saturday. He happened to be walking past us today in another part of Redditch, you know, as if it was a coincidence. God knew what he was doing. And he's moving into the things of God. He's fighting it, he's challenging it. He needs to be dead to sin, dead to the world, and alive in Christ. But God is moving on him. God is making the way. And we only had that opportunity, as I say, because we share who Jesus is. I was a bit put out that I couldn't park, but you know, God's bigger than anything about a car parking space. And God used it, and we were all blessed by it. And we will see testimony abounding from that. As David said, you sow the seed, God's word goes forth, and it produces that multiplication that we read about in Isaiah 55:11. God's word goes forth and accomplishes all he has desired for it. That each man, woman and child that is ready to just accept Jesus, turn their households, turn their families and their successive generations to the things of Christ just by sowing that seed. As we go today, I'll be giving us all a Good News newspaper so we can share the things of Christ, invite people in. Bless Susan, I think she's invited you, has she? Yeah, lovely to see her. Susan's good at that. She's agile, you know. And it's that ripple effect of the gospel going forward. Let us be part of that journey. Dead to sin, alive in Christ. Amen. We're going to move into another time of worship now. Oh, and just as we're moving into that time of worship, just to remind you, Kathy's at work today, so we'll be praying for her later. Dawn and Claire are on holiday, so I'm a little bit envious, you know, they've got a week away, but we'll pray for them. We'll bless that God will touch that. Keith, we know dear, is ill. Gail and Louisa we'll be praying for. And of course, David, we want to pray for his leg. But we're going to move into a time of worship and then we'll have a time of prayer and healing. Let us stand and worship God. I think you might be on a sheet, Matthew.
It's on the sheet. It's what a beautiful name. Number 23 on the sheet.
Find a friend and move together. We're swelling in two big numbers.
Number 23 on the sheet, on the white sheet. What a beautiful name it is.
Your love was great. What the step? Every heart, I worship
Loving the Lord with all their heart, mind, mind and soul and are waiting to be baptized. We are willing to journey through that and talk you through. But if you do know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, praise God. Tell someone. Tell people. Draw them into the things that God is doing in this place and in the churches that preach His word. We're going to stand in a moment and sing 4-2-1 as our closing song. But there's an offertory at the front should you wish to gift to the church. If you have a prayer need or a prayer request, just come at the end and we'll minister and pray accordingly. But we're going to move into our final song, close the service officially in prayer so we can move into refreshments and fellowship and minister here. Of course, like always, we'll also be setting up for the toddlers. Oh, we're not setting up for the toddlers group this week.
Oh, don't do that.
Yeah, Major Dawn said to me, if you set up for it, she said, my congregation will go crazy because they'll be dancing around toys in the spirit on a Sunday morning. So yeah, praise God. No set up tonight then. Let us stand to our feet and we're going to close in prayer before we sing that final hymn actually at this point. Rocks. Susan, close us in prayer please for today. Thank you.
Father, we thank you for this precious time that we have been with you all of us to be this together. In your presence, your word says, better is one day in your courts than to spend 1,000 days elsewhere. Father, how good it is for brothers and sisters to gather like this and to worship your holy name, to praise your holy name, and to give the life that you have given us to the passers by. Father, we thank you for the word that it has spoken to us as well. Father, you are a God who is there with us in a time of trouble. Father, you are an all-sufficient God, we thank you. Yes, we believe that nobody is here by accident. It is your purpose and your plan that everybody that is here, Father, should know you and believe you and should trust in you because you are the way, the truth and the life. Father, we pray for each and everyone that is present here. You know the hearts and the needs of each heart. So please meet their needs in your abundance, Father. As there is summer break and there are no gatherings for children, Father, we have their needs as well. Lead us, guide us, be with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise God. Tuesday, 1 p.m., bring all your children then to litter pick and tidy up the grounds and we'll witness to many. 4-2-1 in the books. Have you been to Jesus for the plenty of power?
Aside the garments that were sainted. Are you washed in the blood?